Welcome to Chemistry with Caroline. In this video, we're going to look at ring contraction rearrangements and E1 reactions. So we're starting out here with a 7-membered ring. We've got a leaving group bromine on there. This is an elimination reaction, so we can predict what products we would see by labeling the carbon with the leaving group on it, the alpha carbon, and then any next door neighbor carbons that contain hydrogen atoms as beta carbons. So you can see to the right-hand side, I have one carbon, so I labeled that beta. And then to the left-hand side, I have another carbon, but there's no hydrogens on it. And so without a rearrangement, I wouldn't expect to have a elimination product on that side. So if we go over to the product side here, we see the beta product here. That would be the expected product. And I still have that 7-membered ring. And the double bond that's formed is between what was the alpha carbon that the leaving group was on and then the beta carbon where the proton was plucked off next door. But in addition to that, I have two other products, and those products look different in that they have 6-membered rings instead of 7-membered rings. So when you have a product that has a different skeletal structure than the starting material, you definitely had a rearrangement. And in this case, we see the ring shrinks from 7 to 6 members. So in particular, this is a ring contraction type rearrangement. So we'll go to the next slide and we can show the mechanism for how these unexpected products formed. I've drawn our reaction scheme again just with the unexpected products here. So unexpected products, those with different skeletal structures of the starting material, would be the products of a rearrangement that occurred. So in an E1 type reaction, the first step in this case is going to be the leaving group leaving. I already have a good leaving group in bromine. So my bromine leaves, and that's going to give me my initial carbocation that is formed. So that gives me this structure. Now, what you want to do when you're looking at rearrangements is figure out what's different, right? So we already know we've gone from 7 to 6 members, but see how you have these methyl groups here that are on the ring? And there's 2 methyl groups coming off of that same carbon. If I look at the products, I have 2 methyl groups coming off of this outside carbon. So that tells me that that carbon has popped out of the ring in this ring contraction. I'm going to number for us just so that we can keep track of where everything goes. So I'm going to start where the carbocation is and number around the ring. So I have a 7-membered ring, so I've just been numbering to 7. So carbon 7 has those methyl groups on it. When a ring contraction occurs, you're going to have a bond shift over, just like a methyl or a hydride shift would happen. It's just that it's connected to the same carbon via the other side because it's a cyclic system. So the bond between carbon 6 and 7 is going to hop over to carbon 1. So carbon 7 is going to pop outside of the ring. So let's draw that product here. Now there's equilibrium arrows when the leaving group leaves because that's a reversible reaction, but shifts tend to be single-headed arrows. The energy that it takes to overcome the reverse activation energy is way too large for the reaction to reverse itself. So now what I have is this. And so if I go back and number again, here's my carbon 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. My arrow had said that carbon 6 was breaking a bond to carbon 7 and forming a new bond to carbon 1, and that's what's shrinking the ring from 7 to 6 members. Carbon 7 has popped outside of the ring and it's lost electrons, and so that's why it's positively charged now. Once this new carbocation is formed, we can look at the predicted products from that structure. So the carbocation is going to be the alpha position, and then I would have beta positions. Those are symmetrical. They're coming off the same carbon, so those 2 methyls would be identical to one another. And then I have another position next door that's different. That would be my beta prime. So for clarity's sake, I'm going to redraw this structure. So I have a carbocation intermediate, a new carbocation intermediate now after this ring contraction. And the base is going to come in and pluck a proton off of the beta position, and those electrons will fold in. And that is how my product forms. So this one that's directly above there. So as I had them labeled, this one would be beta, and this one on the left-hand side would be beta prime. So the formation of unexpected products results from the formation of a new carbocation intermediate due to a rearrangement of the original carbocation intermediate that was generated when the leaving group left. In the case of ring contractions, often what is driving that rearrangement is the increased stability of the smaller size ring. So you see ring contractions often when you're going from a ring larger than 6 to a ring that is 6 or 5. So a 7-membered ring has a difficult time accommodating bond angles of 109.5, that ideal bond angle for all atoms involved in the ring. So 5 and 6-membered rings are sort of the ideal size in terms of electronic and steric repulsion being minimized. And so you will see ring contractions. The other thing that will drive a rearrangement reaction is the formation of a more stable carbocation. So shifting from like a secondary to a tertiary carbocation. So this has been a look at ring contraction rearrangements and E1 type reactions. If you found this video helpful, please like, subscribe, and share with your friends. Thanks.